In the fantastic school systems of the US, colonization of the New World is often taught in generalizations. Hundreds of years of history summed up as Columbus sailing the ocean, pilgrims, colonies, America, and manifest destiny all the way to the Pacific. When history is so simplified, it's often forgotten just how political colonial America was, centuries before the US was even born. Colonization wasn't just natives versus Europeans, it was tribe versus tribe, European versus European. There was entire political dynamics lost to the span of time. The land was eventually dominated by Europeans, but before then, it was a complex web of intertribal and European relationships, sometimes leading to war and devastation on all fronts. Wars for resources aren't new. If other people have something you don't and you fight for it, that's a war for resources. In modern day, the first thought that popped in your mind is probably oil. But in 17th century North America, the most valuable resource was fur. Fur was a status symbol, used to make clothing and hats, and to Europeans, it was a must. What fur was the most sought after? Beaver. This trade of fur, however, led to some unforeseen consequences, spurring one people to invade throughout the Great Lakes region, causing a conflict of truly unknown devastation. The Beaver Wars. Insert joke about certain rodent firing certain anti-tank sniper rifle. What were the Beaver Wars? The Iroquois were the largest force in 17th century New York. They were not one tribe. Instead, the Iroquois Confederacy was a united alliance of five, later six tribes: Seneca Nations, Mohawk, Onondaga, Oneida, and Cayuga. In its founding, the League comprised of what is today upstate New York. They had a complex legal system, and each tribe played an important part to the survival of the Confederacy. Then, the Europeans came. As those numerous post-apocalyptic movies and games mention, population loss leads to power vacuums. New players come in, and there's less stability for old ones. It's believed Native Americans lost 90% of their population to disease brought by Europeans. Even with the smallpox plague, the Iroquois remained a predominant force. Not a puppet of Europeans, but a decider in regional politics and trade. When Europeans first began to settle North America, New England, Canada, and the Great Lakes didn't offer environments for plantations like in the Caribbean and South America. However, they did offer a new resource for pelts. The beaver had nearly been hunted to extinction in Europe, but in the New World, it was plentiful. A whole new market opened up. Who could hunt the beavers? Natives. So began a new relationship between Europeans and native tribes. Natives hunted, sold to Europeans, and would receive metal, jewelry, and weapons in exchange. Europeans made cash back home. The Iroquois, with their increasing power, knew the advantage of this prosperous trade, and benefited greatly from establishing ties with Europeans. As all resource trading goes, it's all fine and good until that resource runs out. Fur trading made tribes powerful, and whoever controlled the fur trade held power over their rivals. So to keep that power, you need fur. Tribes hunted so much to keep up with European demand, beaver populations were depopulated in upstate New York and lower Canada. To keep up with lost beavers and ravaged by smallpox, to the Iroquois, drastic measures had to be taken. Armed with European weapons, the Iroquois decided to expand and seize new hunting grounds, and so began the Beaver Wars. The Iroquois had the blessing of the Dutch, who keep in mind still had New Amsterdam by now, to take any measures possible to secure new furs and profit. The first conquest pushed out the Mohicans and Algonquins by 1630. 10 years later, confident in their strength, the Iroquois drove out the Huron, who were replaced by the Ottawa. Now, these conquests were not pretty, as war often isn't. War raids were fast, violent attacks. Storm a village, kill and torture the men, then kidnap the women and children. Weapons of use were typically tomahawk, arrows, or guns. And with guns, the Iroquois had an incredible advantage over their enemies. So the Dutch weren't too fond of the French, and the Iroquois weren't too very fond of the allies of the French. So when thousands of Iroquois happened to attack New France with Dutch guns, it was surely a coincidence, right? By the 1650s, the Iroquois began attacking the French directly. If you were a colonist in 1650s Quebec, an Iroquois attack was your worst nightmare. Montreal was even a target at times. French allies of the Huron, Wendat, and neutral tribes all had been destroyed, enslaved, or assimilated. I'm not going to go down a list of everyone the Iroquois pissed off. Eventually, the French had enough and formed an alliance with their native friends to fend off attacks, scorching the earth and starving the Iroquois into submission by 1666. With relative peace with France, the Iroquois expanded west. Over a series of decades, they invaded and fought against other alliances, such as the Council of the Three Fires, wiping out populations and conquering Ohio, Michigan, and land all the way to the Mississippi. This is oversimplifying. Wars for Ohio between the tribes sometimes took a decade, and plenty of interpolitical conflicts occurred. The result from this expansion created a massive population of refugees. The Iroquois held these lands for over 50 years, centralizing their culture, position, and government. War raids became more efficient, and tribal politics took less importance over the Confederacy. By the 1680s, war began again when the French attempted to control trade of the Mississippi. War between the French and Iroquois lasted for another decade, until both sides simply became tired of fighting. Meanwhile, the English were simply building up strength, and were now a new formidable enemy. A peace treaty was signed between the chiefs and French leaders, resulting in the Iroquois Confederacy becoming a formidable buffer between the French Canadians and English colonists. Algonquin refugees were allowed back into their old homes. Ohio was split among the Miami in Northwest Ohio and the Shawnee in the Central and South. The Beaver Wars led to the deaths of thousands in raids, battles, and war between tribes and occasionally Europeans. It reflected just how much the drive for trade and wealth can create violence between groups. Just the pelt from this simple animal transformed the demographics of the entire Great Lakes region. An entire conflict left as a footnote in American history books, even though it certainly dominated the politics of 17th century colonial America. This is Cody of Alternate History Hub.